the next day I walk down the same street. I see the same deep hole in the sidewalk. I fall into it. Pretending I didn't see it at first, I still fall into it. And I can't believe I'm in the same place and I struggle to get out. Part number three. Chapter number three. The next day, I walk down the same street. I see the same hole in the street. I fall into the same street, the same hole in the street. And I begin to struggle trying to find out. And I realize I'm in a habit. Something is going on here. It's happening day after day. I find my way out. Part number four. Chapter four. I walk down the same street. I see the hole in the street. I walk around the hole in the street. Chapter number five. Card number five. The next day, I walk down a different street. Isn't that the story of our life? But the story is the journey that we're going on a day-to-day basis that we need to learn to maybe encounter these experiences, learn from them, and choose another street. Walk down a different pathway. Walk a new street, a different street in the journey of our lives. Some of us walk the same street over and over again, fall in the same hole over and over again, wonder why we're in the same hole over and over again. We struggle to get out of the same hole over and over again, and we go back and do it all over again. Sometimes it's based on our beliefs, our thoughts, our ideas. Some of us think, you know, I know that God is a punishing God, and I live that life as God is a punishing God, and I fall into that hole, and I sink into that hole, and I crawl out and wonder where's God's love. And then I go, dagnabbit, and do the same thing all over again the next day. Or I walk in fear, and I wonder about the fears of my own journey in my spiritual life. Will God love me? Will God accept me? Is God's love fully there for me? And I fall into the hole of that fear, and I struggle in that hole of that fear, and I try to get out, and lo and behold, once I get out, dagnabbit, I do it again. I fall in the same hole. The story of our lives, over and over again, repeating beliefs. Some belief that maybe I'm not good enough. Maybe I can't do it. Maybe there's not enough for me in the world. Whatever that belief may be that we hold in our life, we repeat them over and over again. It's the story of our life until one day we choose a new street. The Spirit of God calls us as people to choose a new street, to walk down another street, to make a change. That we've taken the same path far too long and we've fallen into these same holes. We may blame others, we may pretend like it's not there, we may make excuses for the holes in the streets, we do all these kind of things, and one day it happens, the light goes on. I need to choose this different street. It's an awakening, and today you're called to choose a new street, and it is the street called love. Love. Wouldn't it be wonderful if every street was called love? Now, we've seen Lover's Lane, and we look about that, and we say, well, that's where people go and kind of do some things, maybe in the dark of night, in that Lover's Lane, that smooching and that carrying on and all that kind of stuff. But how about a daylight experience where every day the road you're traveling is that love, and you are the lover on that lane. You are the one who's every day living out the love of God in your life. A love that sometimes we don't always fully understand. We don't fully comprehend it. Today, we're celebrating the wonderful voices of inclusion that are part of MCC, part of City of Light, part of Unity, who is part of City of Light, part of the Affiliated New Thought Network. All these different collaborative efforts coming together of different organizations that make up what we call City of Light in its vision, its mission, its direction. Interestingly enough, all these partners coming together in such a spirit of collaboration, working together, sharing a powerful message. What I love is that we have celebrated here, will be the 50th year of MCC's founding. It was the precursor to the Pride movement, to the LGBT Pride celebrations of discovery and proclamation of their own individual freedoms of love and who they are, and proclaiming who they are. MCC was there in 1968, 1 year before. And its powerful message was one of inclusive love, a message that says we from the very beginning say everyone is included. Then we look at Unity. Unity founded 75 to 80 years earlier than that, was founded on the wonderful teachings of New Thought Principles, brought forth by Charles and Myrtle Fillmore, who started this powerful movement. They never once voted to welcome anyone because they didn't have to. Because the teaching was everyone is welcome, everyone is equal, all are in the wonderful love of God, and there is no partiality, there's no difference. We celebrate our affiliation with the New Thought Network of Congregations, 150 congregations around the world who celebrate the power of understanding this ancient teaching. New Thought may be confusing to some, and it's an odd name, really, because we think it's something brand new that someone just came up with. It's the invitation of an ancient understanding that says, I want you to have a new thought. You were thinking this way, but how about having a new thought, a repentance, a change of thought, a new heart, a new outlook? You may thought you can't. How about the new thought you can? You may thought you're not loved. How about the new thought you are loved? You may thought it's not possible. How about the new thought that says all things are possible? You see, we celebrate this wonderful teaching that has echoed down through the ages, and that organization also never had to vote to welcome anyone, because all are welcome. In today's world, we find lots of religious organizations, denominations, churches that are struggling. They've been dealing with the issue of who do we welcome and who do we allow in and how do we celebrate this so-called love of God with people who are different than us. So we have people who pulled aside to create maybe a church of one ethnic group or another. We have people who pulled aside, so no, this church is going to be for this group or that group. And we've labeled our churches, we've labeled our denominations, we've labeled ourselves in some efforts to be separate, somehow creating a separation and a spirit of inclusion, exclusion in our desire to express God's inclusive love. And that we have congregations struggling and fighting and arguing and saying, you know, do we welcome people who are different than us? Do we welcome people who are of different races, different sexual orientations, different outlooks, different gender identities? How do we do with that? How do we say that God is love, and yet we find people who are diverse and we're engaging with them? What do we do, and how do we struggle with it, and then we call a vote, and some say yes and some say no? How difficult that is. Years ago, I attended the Robert Schuller Pastors Conference and had an opportunity to sit with 2,000 ministers from all around the world. We broke down into small table groups of 8 to 10 ministers around the table and began to talk about different issues. And people began to say, you know, we're struggling with women preaching in our church. And men went around the corner, around the circle, said, yeah, what do we do with women? Obviously, a group of men all discussing, what do we do with women? And I said, oh, it's not a problem in our church. And they said, oh, I'm glad you've resolved that. Then the discussion went around and says, what do we do with, you know, racial diversity? You know, people, our churches are now becoming more diverse. And what do we do with that? Oh, that's a problem. So it's not a problem in our church. Then it went on and said, you know, oh, we're struggling with all these kind of issues, and we're trying to figure out what's the right thing to do when it comes to people who are LGBT and all the different sexual orientations. What do we do? How do we welcome them out? And I said, well, it's not a problem in our church. And they said, wait a minute. We're all struggling and fighting with these decisions in our church. You know, what are you doing at your church? I said, ministry. That's what it is. We're just doing ministry. And ministry is the love of God unfolding in unique and powerful ways. Isn't it wonderful to think we don't have to vote to say who's welcome, who's not? That we're part of these wonderful voices of inclusion that have such a rich history. They've said from their very beginning, from their conception, from these organizations all coming together, and we share in such a wonderful collaboration and partnership with each one. Not one of them had to have this discussion. Should we let you in? Should we let you in? Do we let you in? Do we let you in? Are you welcome or not? How do we express God's love if we allow you to speak or you to say something or you to be involved? And you see, we look around the room and we celebrate incredible, rich diversity with intentionality. It says everyone is welcome because that's the love of God. That's the love of God. We're called then to walk down this new street in a world today, and that street is called the love of God. If you're looking for a street name for your day-to-day pathway, it might just be simply that, a street sign when you're at the intersection of what to do and where to go. It's take the street called the love of God and walk down that. And know that when you walk that street, you have to understand what that love of God truly is.
It's inclusive. It welcomes everyone.
There's no scripture that says God welcomes just part of the world. God welcomes a certain sector of the world. God so loved someone more than someone else. It says God so loved the world. That world is each and every one of us. And every living being that breathes and takes a breath is part of this world. And God is loving it. So when we walk down the street of God's love, we understand that we love everyone. Wow. You love your enemies. It may be a challenge for some of us. But how powerful it is that on the street called the love of God, you are loving those who may be those who create obstacles in your pathways or difficulties or challenges for your own life. But as you love in an inclusive manner that disarms and disables old kinds of fear, hatred, and those issues that may come against us. When you walk down the street and call the love of God, there's a wonderful sense that all are welcome there. Red and yellow, black and white, all are precious in God's sight, is the street song that you might sing as you walk. Today, we're struggling who's precious in our world and who's not. Who's valued? Who do we allow in and who do we allow keep out? What walls do we build in our world today that say someone can be welcomed in and others cannot? We think about that, then we have to really question ourselves, what is it we know about the love of God and how it works within our lives? When we understand who we are as created in our divinity, we understand then that who we are is something wonderful, and it begins with a self-love. Have you loved yourself today? Have you loved yourself? Because you haven't done some self-love, it's about time you do it. It's about time you wake up to this wonderful journey of loving who you are, because God created you, and God didn't create junk. God didn't create a mess. God didn't create a fiasco. God created something fabulous and wonderful. And so when we understand this, we understand that our whole journey of who I am is a journey that says I can walk down the street of God's love and know that I can love who I am. I can love who God created me. I can love this wonderful infinite intelligence called God that knew exactly what I needed for my journey in my life. I believe that the infinite intelligence that is the wonderful universe that we call God, that is the infinite knowing, the all wisdom that we call God, knew exactly what was needed for us in each and every scenario of our day-to-day journey, that we might unfold to our highest and best. Aren't you glad God created you just the way you are? And aren't you glad that you can love yourself? For you are a divine creation, beautiful and wonderful. When we understand that, we can understand then that as I learn to love myself, I can easily love my neighbor, my enemy, those around me, my community, and so much more. This love knows no limits. It knows no boundaries. It knows no walls. It knows no barriers. This love welcomes strangers. And it does so in such a powerful way that it creates a sense of oneness. Now, in the MCC movement, we celebrate this wonderful spirit of this inclusion that was founded in 1968 that says, there is a place for everyone in God's love. And we want to create a home, a sanctuary for that. I have to tell you this, that for those of us who've traveled that journey where we felt like we were outcasts and we're looking for a place called a sanctuary, a place that we could call home, a place that loved us, we better be very good at returning that back to the world around us. Isn't it interesting? Many times, those of us who've been oppressed may want to oppress others. Well, I've been oppressed. You should be oppressed too. I've suffered. You should suffer too. You don't know what it's like because I suffered a lot, and I think you should suffer as well. And so our spirit becomes one that we've sidestepped off that beautiful street called God's love. We stepped off the curb. Maybe we've fallen into a hole or gone down an alley or deterred from that journey. The very spirit and essence that we discovered, that we learned that God so loved the world, included us, we are called then to demonstrate that even more. Because what we've experienced, we want to open the doors for others to experience just the same. I love the fact here at City of Light, we bought a building so big that we could share it. Isn't that wonderful? We've got 36,000 square feet to share with others. We can welcome others. Those who've said, I have no place to go. Those who've said, I have no place to do my ministry. Those who said, I don't know where to turn or where to go. We have an open door for them. There are 24 different practitioners, therapists, counselors, teachers, etc., that call this their home on the second floor alone. Wow. They have no place to go, but they found a home. You see, what we found, we share now and give back. When we found that God loved us just the way we are, ooh, our calling is to share that with the world around us of diversity. That we love the world around us just as much as we discover within our own lives. That kind of love helps us to understand that God dwells in everyone, and that the light of God and the spark of the divine is in all. And that we then must become like Jesus, who discovered his divinity. Wow, that's right. Jesus discovering the divinity within him. Interesting, Jesus returned years later after growing up, coming back to the city of Nazareth, his hometown. You'd think everyone would celebrate. Oh, here's Jesus, the one born of a virgin. Oddly enough, nobody knew anything about that. No one had even heard that. No one knew of anything about this kind of divinity. Jesus himself discovered his own divinity, even in that baptism experience, discovering who he was as the child of God. For everything of Jesus' journey is the example set for us of your journey and what we're called to do, just the same. He discovered in this moment of awakening that he has found the wonderful spirit and presence of God within him, and he invites you to do the same. He said, follow me. He said, follow me. He created people who followed after him. Follow in my teaching. Follow in the way. Follow in the example I've given to you. What were we to follow? Of course, follow everything that he laid down for. His example, his pathway, is our pathway. And you are called to discover this wonderful divinity within you that enables you to love, as you may thought you were never able to love. To reach out to a world because you understand a divine presence within you. That the power presence of God in you is something you have the opportunity to share with the world around you. He knew what was true of him must be true of all of humanity. And he invited us to follow in this wonderful journey of awakening, that we then too would become people who understand a divine love flowing in, through, around, and always for us in so many ways. For as we understand this voice of unity, then, that we, through our wonderful experience of collaboration, 2003, the moderator of the Metropolitan Community Churches in the Worldwide Convention shared and asked the question, who are you partnering with? We heard this very strong by those who attended that global conference and realized, wow, the question is, who do you partner with in this world? Who are you partnering? And as MCC began to partner with other denominations and other movements, and there became a crossover between the United Church of Christ, between Bishop Yvette Flunder, if you know her, and her wonderful movement of the family ministries coming together, there began such a partnership flowing across. Many people began to say, look up to say, who's your dance partner in life? Who are you going to dance with? Who are you going to join with? And here at City of Light, we found a wonderful opportunity to partner with so many wonderful ministries, Unity being one of them, to join with the wonderful, powerful teaching and the celebration of resources that are there. But the Unity message is that there is one, and we are all one, and we are bound together. I love this text. It says, above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us together, which builds a bridge together. A bridge, a wonderful bridge of love. And when we understand this message and how important it is, we find it echoed in all of our journeys, all of our pathways, that love is this bridge and is an element that binds and holds together. Now, I'm learning how to cook, okay? I can't say that I'm the best, but I am reading a recipe, and I can make a mean Waldorf salad, Robert says. I've mastered macaroni salad and the fine art of chopping carrots and chopping celery and making a wonderful mix. I've learned that there's something that's needed in so many recipes. It's the binding agent. Something that's there. Is it the egg that binds in your meatloaf?
Is it the Melper flower that creates a binding? What is it that does that holds all these wonderful ingredients together? Well, what is the ingredient that holds us together as we walk this journey of life? It's love. It's this wonderful bridge of love. It's a wonderful bridge of love that just sets aside all ideas of differences. I want to say that in our world today, where so many of us are looking at one way or the other, we're looking at separations, we're looking at divisions, and I want to say stop. Stop asking the how and the why and the where and the what to the who. And just love. Just walk this road of this life with just love. What if we stopped and just loved instead of argued and disagreed? What if our Facebook postings were just love? And what if we posted and shared and supported the power and presence of love being at work within us? What if we found that this ingredient was the binding ingredient that would pull us all together and create a world that was strong, that world that was uplifted, and a world that was positive and encouraged? Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 2 says, if there be any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, fulfill ye my joy that ye like-minded, people who partner with one another, people who collaborate with one another, having the same love and being of one accord and being of one mind. One mind. Mind of God. That infinite intelligence and infinite wisdom. We're called to be of that one mind. That love binds us together, that we all may have the mind of Christ. That we may think, that we may begin to believe, that we may begin to work in a world of this love that makes us one. A love that binds us together, even though the world may want to pull and tear us apart. I'm so moved as I read this past week about Nelson Mandela in prison. And the story of his 27 years of being a prisoner in South Africa, in the apartheid regimes. A world of great argument and division and separation being pulled apart. Racial division and racial anger and so much more began to be escalated over the years in the nation of South Africa. But he sat in a prison, and he speaks and writes there are movies and stories unfolding his particular journey of love and respect, of a love that respected those who were his jailers, and his jailers having a love and respect for when he was released, and all the opportunity in the world as he became South Africa's first black president, all the opportunity in the world to retaliate, all the opportunity in the world to punish, all the opportunity in the world to say, this is what you did to me as a captor, this is what you did to oppress me, this is how you held me back, this is what you did to destroy me, I now retaliate, tit for tat. There's nothing more powerful than the wonderful sense that this love bound him together to create a powerful leadership in South Africa that made it a powerful nation that went through the apartheid times because it was the demonstration of love that overcame all obstacles. It binds us. It brings us. It creates unity, harmony, and a spirit of oneness. How beautiful it is that we understand then that wonderful voice that comes not only from MCC and from Unity is joined then with the affiliated New Thought Network, a network of all these wonderful congregations coming together and sharing resources and ideas, but under the one umbrella that says we believe in the voice of oneness, not a voice of duality, a voice of good and evil, but a voice that there's one power, one presence, and that's the divine. And that oneness is what keeps us and holds us together. That we should see that the greatest thing that we can do is stop thinking of ourselves as being a created being, but allowing God being in oneness, allowing God to be in and through us. Sometimes we're so busy thinking, I'm a created being, I'm a human being, I'm a person in this world, but no, you're the revelation of God. The greatest thing you can do is just stop. Allow God to be God in you in every moment of your day. Allow God to be God in you. The powerful message of that New Thought movement, of all these congregations joining together, is an ancient truth. That we are this wonderful oneness, that we are all one. We are the answer to Jesus' prayer. Do you all recall the passage of scripture in John 17? When Jesus, the night before he died, prayed one of the most powerful prayers. Oh, you may think it's the Lord's Prayer that you say. I believe it's one of the most powerful prayers of all, that his earnest desire was that we might understand being one, not divided, that we might understand unity, harmony, we might understand inclusion, we might live it out every single day, that we might just let God be God, and how important that is in the journey of our day-to-day walk. His prayer was that he prayed that we might be one as God and he are one, that we might follow that example in awakening. He didn't pray it once. You realize it's stated five times in five different ways. He expressed this desire in prayer that the world, that you may understand you're one. You're one with God. You're one with one another. You're not separated. You're not divided. There's no gap. There's nothing that can separate us from the love of God. There's nothing that can tear us apart, but yet we've listened. We've walked down streets and fallen on holes of fear over and over again. They keep telling us we're separated. We're not loved. We're not included. We're not good enough. We're not this. We're sinners. We're bad. Or something about us is evil. And we wake up and haul ourselves out of a hole and the next day walk down the same path. Now, the beauty is this wonderful understanding that we are one in this divinity. We are one, and the divine is in you. We need to allow it to just come forth, to speak, to be shared, to be the light that shines in our world. One of the things that we know, that as we walk down the streets, the street called the love of God, in a new way, we don't walk just for ourselves, but for all humanity. How important it is. We don't take this journey of life just for ourselves, but your life has an impact on all the world. When we understand that, we make a big shift. I'm not living my life just for me. I'm living my life for you and you and you and you and you and you, for everyone, for the world, because everything I do ripples out and has an impact in my world around me. I don't live selfishly. I live with the spirit of sharing and collaboration and partnership, working together. I live in those wonderful world of understanding that as I walk down this street called love, it's not just for myself, but for all humanity. There's an interesting Native American proverb expressed in simple ways, this: when we walk down the road, we must be careful, for we know the faces of our future generations. Children yet to be born are watching from above. Think about those yet to come looking down, those who are yet in the divine realm of God, waiting to be birthed, waiting to come into this world, looking and watching our actions in the world that we're creating for others. Are we creating a world that is a pathway of a street called love? Are we walking it? Or are we walking day by day, time after time, falling in the same traps that have been set for us? Traps that want to trip you, that you fall into fear. Traps that want to trip you, that you fall into doubt and question, wonder, separation, and argument over who's in and who's out, who's welcome and who's not. See, today, our journey of celebration of all these voices of inclusion is a wonderful journey that says this street called God's love is wide, inclusive, welcoming, and is one that allows love to flow freely. Let me tell you, this love was meant to be flowing and to flow in such a way that everywhere it goes, it builds a bridge. How many of you are watching the lava flow in Hawaii? Wow. It's crossed over all kinds of gulfs and gaps. That lava, in its hot molten state, moves and crosses over any kind of barrier in its way and has created bridges, even obliterating a lake completely, crossing from one side to the other, pushing its way into the ocean. This is the love of God from our innermost being, called to, like a volcano, erupt. Let the love flow down this street called God's love. Let it flow and create bridges connecting and obliterating obstacles in its way, allowing love to be so powerful that it's demonstrated in our word, actions, and deeds. I invite you today, let's walk down a new street. Not a street of fear, not a street of doubt, not a street of separation, not a street of who's in and who's out, but the street of God's love. Today, I invite you to demonstrate your willingness as I offer you one of these wonderful rainbow balloons at the close of this service, and invite you to tie it on this bridge and say, I walk down a new street today. It's a street called God's love. And in that, I'm building a bridge of inclusivity. I welcome all. I welcome the diversity of this world. I welcome those who are outcasts and aliens and those who are on the outside of society's norms. I welcome those who are different than me. I welcome those who speak differently or think differently. I welcome them because I believe God so loved the world, and I too am called to do the same. If that be your desire, please rise with me in this moment. And let's share as the voices of celebration sing again, oh happy day, when spirit washed that fear that keeps knocking us down in those same old streets away. We're going to sing it together, and I invite you to step to the rear of the sanctuary and pick up your balloon from one of our ushers and come on forward and tie it on to our rainbow bridge of love, proclaiming, I am building that love today, a bridge of love. Let's sing it together. Make your way back there and pick up a balloon. Happy day.